Hi everyone, my name is Glenn. You'll be surprised to hear that I'm 25 years old and I'm the father of 50 children. Yeah, that's not a small number by anyone's standards. And you're probably wondering, why so many? And more importantly, how? I'll tell you everything you need to know. Just watch till the end. When I went to college, I planned to study law or finance or something. It seemed to me that exactly these professions, as never before, are important. And I can find a vacancy in any city and even country. I got a degree in finance, but I just couldn't get a job. My dreams shattered in a harsh reality. I thought that that was it. I don't know what to do with myself anymore. I don't know how to live anymore, and in general, what do I do in this planet? To be honest, my choice was influenced by my rich father. I mean, he hasn't lived with us for a long time. I only grew up with my mother. She worked tirelessly to give me an education. And my father thought that I was just a mistake, and so he washed his hands of me. He started another family. Only later I found out that he had asked my mother to remove me while she was still pregnant. That was the reason for the separation. I know we lived side by side in the same city. I saw him sometimes and he me, but we both pretended not to know each other. Anyways, after graduation, I got a bit depressed. I couldn't find any job to ease my mother's worries. Couldn't think of a plan or any plan of action. It was terribly depressing. Eventually, my old acquaintance Elliot offered to help me with his job for, you know, some extra cash. We met by chance in the streets and got to talking, and I immediately said yes, not even asking about what I would do. He told me the address, and I went there the next day. A special school opened up in front of my eyes, where troubled teenagers from all over the city were studying there. Most of them either had no parents or they did, but there was no use for them anymore in their eyes. Elliot worked as one of the teachers, and he invited me to help him during lessons to monitor discipline, check their homework, attendance, and just typical assistant stuff, and check for forbidden subjects within the school walls. I was surprised at first, but I didn't back down because I did need the money. First day seemed like the worst day of my entire life. As soon as I entered the classroom, teenagers started throwing notebooks and books at me and stuff at me. They were all swearing loudly, cursing, calling me names. After work for 4 hours, I walked out of the classroom and ran towards the exit, but Elliot stopped me. He said that their reaction was normal and that I should give them a chance to get to know me and let them open up. I couldn't stand being there for a couple of hours. I mean, what was there to talk about? I didn't agree until Elliot pulled out the money. He said that he would pay well. He just needed my help temporarily. After taking a couple of breaths outside, I went back into the classroom and started observing them. There were about 50 teenage kids in that class, all with their own personalities, complicated fates, and each with their own difficult lives. But one thing they had in common was that they didn't trust adults, didn't trust, and had aggression boiling up inside of them. Elliot was very handy with them, even able to convey the right lessons, and they listened to him. In the course of his work, he taught me some tricks to win them over, and the first trick was that to never force them to do anything, especially with threats of force or consequences. The second was not to denounce their parents, because many didn't have parents, and those who did, they didn't care about their kids. The third rule was to always be yourself, because kids could sense hypocrisy and would not forgive a setup. I didn't think I could do it, personally. For a whole week, I went there with no spirit. And I left the same way. Their attitude towards me as an outsider hadn't changed, and I hadn't expected otherwise. A month went by like that, and Elliot was sent on a business trip. He left the program, explained what was going on, and asked me to be lenient. And guess what? This class, on my first day, on my own burned textbook bag, glued my shoes to the floor, put grease on the blackboard, and nearly punctured my car tires. I was ready just to go to the police. I packed up my stuff and walked angrily out of the classroom, slamming the door loudly. But as I walked down the corridor, I heard some shouting from the kids. I wanted to pass by, but I didn't. I went in there and saw my student lying on the floor. He was sort of the leader of the class. Everyone was listening to him. There was a man standing over him. He was huge, taller than me by 2 heads, pumped up and angry. I realized he was hitting Jim. They both looked at me, and the man told me to buzz off, but I didn't. I gathered all my strength into a fist, and when he swung again, I grabbed his arm. We got into an altercation. I shouted that I was going to call the police. Jim shouted to let me go, and the man was like a bloody robot. He didn't tire and handed me like a plush toy. I was exhausted and could hardly move. He told me to go away again. I told him that he did not dare touch my student. At that moment, the guards burst in, and that man was grabbed and pushed out of the school. Jim helped me up. He went to the backyard. He gave me some water to wash my face with. A couple of minutes of silence, he asked why I stood up for him, even though I would probably lose. I laughed and said that I just wanted to protect him. He was my student, and that man had no right to hurt him. Suddenly, Jim started crying. According to this boy, it was his stepfather who regularly abused him, taking his anger and resentment on him for having a sad life. I told my mother more than once, but she doesn't kick him out. She said she still loves him, he told me. I listened to him, but it was a very honest conversation. And then Jim thanked me, saying that it was the first time anyone had ever stood up for him. Then he made me promise not to tell anybody, and we went our separate ways. Today I went back to class, and strangely enough, nobody made fun of me. Everyone sat back in their seats, no shouting. They were just waiting for the lesson like Elliot had. I led the class and went on like that every day. Gradually, each of the students approached me with their problems, and I gave them advice to the best of my ability and my own personal experience. Some of the guys just needed an easy conversation, and their spirits were immediately lifted. I realized that this was Jim's doing. The boys in the class listened to him as their leader. The boys and I went for another 2 months of me teaching them. I gave them field trips, gave them cultural lessons. Sometimes we even sang songs. Found that some of these kids could actually draw. Some actually liked to sing, and some enjoyed dancing, cooked, and even embroidered. Three of the kids are awesome at writing poetry, and all these talents they had hidden behind a bunch of masks. Jim wrote songs and music himself. Everybody was shocked when they found out about each other's talent. We kept it a secret, just enjoying the moment. And so, when my students and I were supposed to meet for an evening walk in the city forest, sit around a fire, something happened. While the boys and I were sitting there chatting, the parents of the pupils came to us, Jim's stepfather being one of them. They accused me of being a bad influence on their kids, called me stupid, and promised to put me in jail for working in a school as a teacher without proper training. The students stood up for me. Jim's stepfather hit me again. I fell to the ground. Such a scolding started there. Confrontation between the kids and the parents. Everyone was shouting, blaming me. The police came to the noise. We were taken to the police station, but I dropped my claims against Jim's stepfather so he wouldn't go to jail. The parents demanded my dismissal. The school administration kept quiet. Dad, you know I paint. Emma writes poetry, by the way. Justin sings, and Kevin even sews, one of the students said. The parents fell silent. The students spoke in my favor again. They interceded, asking me not to be sacked. This made the parents even angrier, and they said that they wouldn't give them up if they didn't stop defending me. Do you understand what happened then? The kids asked me to adopt them. All of them. It was a very long process filled with bureaucracy. It took more than a year. I didn't have the money to support them, so the court almost turned me down. Our story went all over town and beyond. The press wrote about us, and my father turned up. That's another story. I'll just say that he regretted leaving me. He saw how I grew up, and so he gave me a gift. He signed over some of his property as me as an heir. That was when I became rich right away. After that, I was approved for adoption. My parents either gave up their children themselves or the children forced them to. All in all, I've now the father of 50 children ever since. My mom helps me raise them, and so does Elliot. I continue to work at the school at the same time. I'm getting my training in teaching. All in all, life has changed drastically, but mostly for the better. What do you guys think? If you liked the video, then please leave a like and comment down below. And don't forget to subscribe.